I've been looking forward to today for a long time. I've got a three-year-old at home, and I'm just really happy that today somebody might actually listen to me. I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional owners and their ancestors, past and present, and all the traditional owners and all the places that we work. I'm independent at the moment. I work for the river, and the way that I do that is by basically helping people get to the point. And so that means sort of integrated comms in teams, working as an interface between researchers and traditional comms groups. My background's in science. I was a fish ecologist for about 15 years. Worked all over the world, from the wet tropics to Kakadu, in the Basin, Sam and others in the Macquarie, and in the US. And during that time, I've had a lot to do with Craig Boyes, who's from New South Wales DPI Fisheries. He and I have maintained a healthy bromance for the last 20 years. He's based in Port Stephens. Unfortunately, he wasn't able to make it today as one of his sons is quite sick. It's a real honour to be able to present some of this work. All of the work that I've done all over the place, it's been really interesting and everything, but when I started talking to Craig about this issue of screening, it really captured me as probably one of the most important things that might happen in the basin over the next sort of 10 years, I'd say. So this is the point. Millions of native fish are being lost every year from the river. They're sucked into pumps and they're diverted down channels. These losses are completely unnecessary. Proper screening can keep fish in the river and money in local communities. And water users really want to address this issue, and so we're going to help them apply this international best practice. So I'm going to talk to you a bit today about some of the evidence that we have for this. This is a 12-inch pump. This is pretty standard. It doesn't have a screen on it. These pumps take 240 fish on average per day, native fish. In New South Wales, there's over 4,500 of these pumps. So if you extrapolate out of this, you're looking at this figure of 97 million fish, native fish per year, that are being lost from the river. So it's completely insane, and it needs to stop, basically. If you were going to stock those fish, that would be about $72 million worth of stocked fish. Jason's talked about stocking this morning, and we stock about 2 million Murray cod, silver perch, golden perch every year in New South Wales. Downstream from Yarrawonga, there's 5 diversions. In a 90-day period, those structures diverted 21 million eggs and larvae of those species. So you start to kind of get the scale of what we're facing here. When you say we're going to talk about screens, we're going to put screens in, people kind of freak out. Like, screens are a bit of a swear word, actually, because this is what people have as screens, which is basically like chicken wire and cable ties, and they don't work. So it's got this bad sort of reputation. This is an industry leader from down in the Riverland, Fruit Grower, and they're pumping water out of a Ramsar site to irrigate crops, and that site receives Commonwealth water. So if this is sort of the best in the business, and they're having all these troubles with their filters, you know, what does the other end look like? And so most of these pumps don't have screens on them. This is what you would do to solve that. This is technology out of the US. They've been doing this for 100 years. They've really developed a lot of this technology. This is a cone screen. So the pump line kind of comes in underneath here and comes up. So you just lie it down on the bank, basically. You've got this cone on the top. And then on the side here, you've basically got these brushes that rotate around. So that's a powered unit. And basically the whole idea is you're lowering the velocity at which that the fish interact with. So there's not just this fast current, you know, and they can't actually get in there. And you can have quite small mesh sizes, down to about 3 millimeters. So they don't get blocked. This is a different design. This is called a T-screen. It's got a rotating drum down the bottom here. So basically, this is a fine stainless steel mesh in a drum that rotates around on a bearing there. And then this is the brush here. And you can have a brush on the inside. So they're not clogging at all. This is what we do for diversions. This is a site in the US. So this looks pretty much like any diverted channel that we have in Australia. So here they've put this plate screen on an angle here running across the river, or the diversion, I should say. And then at this sort of downstream side, there's an outlet that goes back into the river and the diverted water. And any fish that come into this area, they're diverted back into the river. And on the front here, you've got this screen, the brush, and that just basically brushes back and forth. If you've got velocity, it's a lot easier because you have some sweeping velocity there and the water will actually start cleaning the screen. So there's some challenges with lower flows. This is another option. It's called a traveling belt or an escalator screen. And basically it's lots of little panels, just like an escalator in a shopping center. And it just rotates around. And these are awesome for putting in banks, especially if you've got a lot of debris coming down. So like algal mats, big logs, stuff like that, that material can be lifted over. It can actually be a way to remove that water, that debris from the water. And there's horizontal options too. So this is a small stream. Basically, you've got two flumes coming down here. The water from upstream comes into the flumes, and then the one on the left here, this is turned off, and so you can see the screen there. So this is a horizontal screen, and the one on the right's still running. The water basically just trickles down through that, and there's no suction on there. So fish can swim quite freely and exit the system down there, and the diverted water goes down through there, or you can have it going outside. And you can make basically just scale it up to pretty massive installations. So Craig and his colleagues and a few other people have been doing some experiments on this. Okay, let's do it in Australia, look at Australian fish. So they built screens and used Didson sonar, basically like fancy fish finders, to watch fish interacting. And so you'd be able to see individual fish swimming out. And what they found is that these proper screens work. Their data showed that it reduces fish loss by 90%. So if we put these on every pump, say hypothetically, that's 87 million native fish per year that we would be keeping in the river. But they're not just good for fish. They reduce or eliminate blockages of the irrigation lines. They secure the water supply because there's not as much downtime. You don't have to go and backflush your pump or go down and pull debris out of it, pull turtles out of it and platypuses and stuff. Seriously. You can improve the quality of extracted water. So that water is cleaner, right? And so then you can convert to micro drip feed systems and stuff and use water more wisely. Reduces energy costs because you don't have as much load on the pump, so you're saving fuel. Reduces the maintenance costs, like I mentioned before, water use efficiency, and it creates a new industry, manufacturing, installing these things. Here's an example from Oregon. This is a thing called the farmer screen. This is basically like a big version of what I showed you before. The water's going to be coming away from us here, going down these flumes. The water's diverted out the side there. Here's how it works. You've got the river up the top here, got gates at the top, which basically just open and close completely, so you don't have any impacts there on fish. This can handle up to 390 megalitres a day, so it's a pretty good size. And one of the advantages of this, like I said, was that you're getting this better quality water. So they're able to convert 11 kilometres of canal, open canal, to pipe. And they're also able, in a lot of these sites, if you've got some head on them, you can install hydropower units. So we could use solar here in Australia for some of this stuff. Downstream from this, the farmers could install center pivot irrigation systems, micro irrigation systems. So they're using a lot less water. So this irrigation district now diverts 40% less water to irrigate the same number of acres with the same productivity. And from a fish protection perspective, they removed 147 pumps from that system that were impacting fish. So you can probably, in your backyard, you've got a spot like this on your river that you could think, oh, that'd be cool to have one of those in there. Over there, they've had pretty good adoption. They haven't had legislative change. It's basically been, they say no one sells a screen like a rancher with a screen, basically. And that's what we'd like to do here. Water users in Australia definitely are on board with this. This is a quote from Gavin McMahon earlier this year on ABC Rural saying, landholders have been telling us that their pumps are getting clogged. There's just a plethora of fish. They seem to get into the supply and block the filters. And this particularly happens like during large carp events as well, is one of the issues there. So there's a few of these misconceptions, like why hasn't this happened? People have been talking about this in Australia for like 80 years. You know, Craig's given similar talks like this before. Well, there's a few of these key misconceptions. One of them is that the screens don't work in Australia, and that's because people think of this type of structure. It's just like any technology, you know, you get the good technology and you apply it and you can get it to work. Irrigators don't want screens. That's just not true. If you're running a business, you're just reducing your overheads. It's a no-brainer, you know? So that one there, this site here, the quote for that is about 25 grand to fix that. So for a large orchard, it's nothing, right? So there's this thing about the problem's too big and expensive to fix. Well, it's kind of like fishways, and like Matt was saying, you know, it's about prioritizing sites. So on some of those big channels, well, you only need to put the one, maybe it's a more expensive project, but you screen the main diversion. You don't need to screen every single pump further down. Part of the problem is it's really a comms issue, right? So most water users simply don't know that proper screens exist. Like, I've been into heaps of pump shops all around when I travel around. And my little thing is like I go in and say, oh, have you got any screens for pumps, and see what people have got. And basically people just don't know that they're out there. So this isn't just some fantasy like, oh, we're going to get these screens. We've partnering with AWMA. Brett Kelly's here. Thanks, Sam. And this technology is available. These guys are ready to build these things. So this is the situation we currently have. The US is already in the river getting on with the game, and we're sitting up here in the bank in Australia sort of waiting for somebody to take this leap and commit to this. But it's time for it to happen, and I'd like to see that happen this year. What we would like to do is a series of showcases. This isn't an experiment. These aren't like pilot study sites. This is just showing people that it works. So what we want to do is showcase the technology at high profile priority sites, range of fish, water users, different diversion sizes, and different types of screens. We have created a diversion screen reference group, which includes every jurisdiction. And there's a lot of interdisciplinary expertise there. So there's engineering, there's fish biology, policy people on that. And so with this, we'd like to do the economic analysis, cost benefit of like, you know, proving that this farm saved whatever. The fish monitoring, population monitoring, we don't have good data on. Okay, what impact is that having? Like, how many, I keep trying to figure out, I wonder how many fish are actually in the basin. You know, that's kind of come up a couple of times today. What's the impact of losing 97 million fish a year? And obviously communication. So we'll be building a website, putting the data on there, you can get in there and analyze it, have a look yourself. Basically about showing people how it works so that we can start saving fish and saving money and saving water. So basically, this is a giant of river restoration that Australia has essentially done nothing about. And I think it's time that we did that. Thanks a lot. Thank you.